coming for the Work Health and Safety tutorial tonight, which by our government website has been well coded. You can see the code on our screen. We do have a few people here, so you can introduce yourself with your first name and please tell us what's your background at work, so we know all how to relate to this topic easily.
I'm Robert, I'm currently looking for a job. I'm Sash, work for New South Wales Police Department, Admiral.
I'm Trina, I'm advice.
Thank you, I'm in charge.
Very good, thank you everybody. Now, when we talk about work health and safety, we always refer to the short expression WHS. The topics that WHS covers are all those being on the screen. Please do take the notes. Notepads if you need to, that I have provided for you. There are some printouts that will help you to understand each and every of this topic. But starting with the whole of the health, safety and work, we really want to define what work health safety means. So work health and safety, it shows us from the diagram that we have on the screen, it's responsibility, improvement, the performance, prevention, consultation, minimizing the risk, training, injury-free workplace. Now, injury-free workplace, that's a question that a lot of people will think, oh yeah, I know what that means. But what it really means, what is workplace? I've got some printouts that they can help you with some of these definitions. And just by defining workplace, it might help you to understand that every industry that we work presently, we have worked before, and as we have someone here looking for new job environment, so we'll be defining that workplace has a meaning to something that we haven't discovered before. When we're in the office and we do our jobs, and if someone was to ask us, like we have here someone doing florist job, and he's asked to deliver flowers to some other destination. Workplace can automatically mean the place they're delivering the flowers, the vehicle, the transport they're in. So it's not just concerning us the office, the hallway of the office, the building, the flower shop in our case. But who's the worker? Again, it doesn't necessarily mean that work health and safety involve only the person that is employed in our office, in our building, in our floor shop. It can be any volunteer, it can be a student, it can be a visitor from another industry. So we're trying to not minimize, but to expand our understanding of workplace and the worker itself, which work health and safety does cover. Now, health and safety at work, what does that mean? As we discussed earlier, as it says here, it's your office or the center. It can be a hospital, so airport, so we can think a little bit more broad, not just office itself closed. It can be the vehicle, so the transport itself, as we discussed it earlier. Any community settings. So in this case, maybe you can help me out. What else? What else can be the work that we do? If you do have any of these, please don't be too concerned about jumping in and give any of your opinion to this topic.
Now, question?
Yes?
So this involves primary workplaces, as you said, also going to other people's workplaces as well?
Other people's workplaces that involve our work. So as long as we are on duty, as long as we're performing, just like we have the postman coming and delivering.
So the off-duty,
they still, off-duty is off-hours. So we're not, as long as we're not performing, as long as we're not doing the job. Once you finish with your hours, you're not performing while you're in a car, on a plane, in a hotel, while you're not performing and you're out of the office hours, work health and safety does not cover you. Yes.
So that means a courier delivering something or picking something up is also affected even though it's unemployed by you.
If they're employed by me and they're delivering stock.
But if they're not employed but except for that particular product for a pickup or delivery service?
Well, if they're not employed, why would they be delivering for
But if they're not employed by you,
So they are employed with me. They can be casual and they're employed with the company. If they're contracting, they still are working within the company.
So
and there is another section in the work health and safety that those people will need to read in regards to their contract. So it needs to fall under their contract.
But what if they're not employed by your organisation, but you use them, like we often use...
They need to look closely to the company that they work for. So they're covered by their work and health safety company. So they're still covered, but they need to know who they're covered for. They need to talk to their management, the first employer. So if their employer asking another company to take this person to do job for them, they still... Just like when you're looking for a job and you go through an agency and the agency finds you a job elsewhere, so you still work closely to that agency. In our case, because we're talking about work health and safety, agency doesn't look after your work health and safety, but automatically as soon as you sign the contract with a particular company to do the job, this is where you're looking for your work health and safety.
Can you explain the shopping centres?
Shopping centres, yes, that's very good actually. You know, we have security, we have shops, we have a lot of people that work there. So everyone that is employed under the cover of that centre, they need to closely look at their employees' work health and safety. So the shopping centre not necessarily might have the work health and safety policy for everybody, but they will have that for particular people, such as cleaners, people that are looking after elevators, for example, the security guards, but not necessarily for every employee of the shop or the store in this case, because they are separate businesses. They're separate industry.
So customers shopping are not covered?
Definitely not. They're not employed.
And Woolworths would have their own work?
Customers would be covered by any injuries if they... For example, being injured, let's say shopping centres, again, we go back to that because it's a very good question. If there is a wet floor, would that be a potential hazard to us? Do we think wet floors can slip on the floor? Definitely, yeah. So the shopping centre is looking after that. If the customer, if the visitor of the shopping centre decide to go and claim any injuries, this is who they will be dealing with. The management of the shopping centre, looking closely to the work health and safety of the well-being, the people that work there and people that are visiting their centre.
So you have the big shops like Target inside the Westfields that have their own work health and safety overlap.
That's right. So they need to talk to each other. But I would say this case would be Target, because me, if I was there as a customer, I would talk to the personnel of Target and how they deal with their work health safety policies and procedures. With the shopping centre, it will be communication that I wouldn't be particularly concerned because I'm not the employee, I'm the visitor there. But if I was the employee, yes, definitely talking to my manager, because that would be my first concern to talk to my management. Any other questions?
What about help for volunteers?
Same thing, if you were to volunteer your work to a specific industry, this is who you talk to the management, because they will be the first point of interviewing you. You visit them, you explain who you are and why you're there, and if they want to take you under the umbrella of the industry, work health and safety is what concerns you with the industry, within the industry, but nothing out of that.
So whether you're paid or unpaid, they're still responsible for you?
As long as you do enter the place and they give you a badge as your visitor, just like, for example, we go to Woolworths or Coles and you're a visitor from another industry, you check the particular product, how much they have in stock, how much need to be replaced, or any of your concerns, you are there, you put yourself in the visitor's book, they know you're there, that you're part of their team, you're part of their employment staff for that time. So they should be looking after you. So that would cover you.
So if a courier was to deliver a device or something to a company, and they get a badge so they can walk in,
happens on that property, your management and the management of that particular place, office, they will be discussing if there were some injuries. Right. So we spent quite a good amount. We can talk about this after the session, one-to-one if we would like to. And I think we pretty much discovered what is hazard, by giving all this small and big example that was very good discussion. So anything including work practice and procedures that are potential to harm is basically hazard to art. And hazard is injury, but not necessarily only an injury. Injury can be sickness as well. So would you feel safe going to a place where you know that there is a bacteria going around you? Would you like to go there and get sick? Would you be performing as well? How much would that affect you? Is all part of work health and safety. So here we come into the next topic that we would like to discuss again, just to make, to differentiate between the hazard, the illness, and injuries. We have different types, and they can be acute, so they're immediate, chronic, they're more hidden, so again, something that may happen, the way we're sitting, we have a positioning ourselves at work, how healthy is that going to be for us if we don't move enough, or if we move constantly standing on our feet, would that affect our performance as well, and how much would that affect us? And then again, closely to this acute and chronic hazard, as you can see on the screen here, we have common and high risk hazard. And common will come to something that we do every day. We stop paying attention to it because mechanical, we're just people. We just go, yes, we'll keep going. Yes, question.
What time frame do these bylaws last for? Is there a certain time period where you work?
There should be a certain for the legislation, for the procedures we're talking about?
Yes.
Well, that's for the management to decide, but they should have time frame when they can go back and look at their policies. Especially if there's an injury or hazard that does repeatedly happen, so they will have to go back to their policies and decide what has to change.
Yeah, I do know some companies review them in 12 months, so it depends on the policy of the company.
It depends on the policy of the management of that industry.
It's just a moment now, everyone's using Wi-Fi, but if it turns out to be Wi-Fi is dangerous for you, is that going to come under this legislation or is it going to be something?
Well, that depends on the management, what they decide to do. It's just like if you were to work for a company that they working with cigarettes, and they would preferably like, and they would say that they want smokers to work in the company because that's what they promote. But now when you buy a packet of cigarettes, it says it's very critical, it's very serious, it can cause illness, anything. But if you're not a smoker, that will affect you in a great deal. Personally, I'm not a smoker. I would be affected. I wouldn't be able to stand in an office if people smoke there, even in outside where people smoke. I wouldn't like to be surrounded with people that smoke cigarettes. So that will affect personally my work performances. So here, it's a good question because we can lead to the hazards, potential hazards. They can be all different. They can be physical. They can be ergonomic. They can be chemical. Biological, radiation. Now, talking step by step, what all of them means, stating, and I've got printouts for you to read those issues and hazards more in detail. You probably ask yourself, as I had a question before earlier, what's the difference between physical and ergonomic? Well, physical is something that affects our health, and it can be internal. And by touching our body, so external as well. It can be the noise, it can be any big vibrations. Vibration can cause a lot of dizziness, you won't be able to perform as much. Radiation, that can be, so we classify it in a different level of radiation, but again, it's physically. If your body doesn't perform in the best way that you could, you've been affected. So all these hazards potentially are connected. They have a lot of similarity, but we still try to differentiate. If you go and we had an example earlier, slippery fall in shopping centre, would that affect you physically or emotionally, or both? And I would recommend both. But what is it, ergonomic? It has that funny name that someone asked me before, ergonomic. What is the meaning behind it? If you remember, in the beginning of the session I mentioned, positioning ourselves at work. We're sitting for too long or we're standing for too long. How do we see that work? Maybe not after the first few hours in the day, or maybe not the first few days or a week. We'll feel eventually pain in our back if we sit for too long, we're not having much of movements. If you're not sitting properly, probably lower back.
So physical is more than that.
It's more of a direct contact, but then again, as we pointed out in the previous slide, we said it can be noise. So we're not physically affecting our body, but mentally it does affect us. We hear the noise, yes? We hear the noise and it does affect our performance, and we can't concentrate. If you are to work in the office on a very important document, reading or writing, you probably won't be able to concentrate as much. With the ergonomic, the pain can be coming later on, as I said, maybe in a week or two. The way we're typing, maybe the seat is not the best, which is physical to us and very important. So we might have some pain in our joints. But let's look at it closely and discover why so. Different, but then again, affecting each other's, all these hazards. Sorry, you had a question.
Yeah, on the physical side, it's not just about being in a noisy environment, it's like in office, but also if you're on a construction site. Yeah,
well, this is why they have protective gear, and after we finish the session, you can look at some of the props that are put there for all these hazards. But the time is running, so yes, physical hazards, just by, as you said, yes, work in a building industry or motor industry, we do have special gear. Work in a field, we need to have special gear, especially the sunscreen, hat, gloves, long sleeve. Yes?
How so psychological, how would that affect your work?
Psychological, let's go to that. It does affect our emotions, and if we feeling like we've been either bullied, teased at work, if there was understaffed and you had to perform more than you would for a day and to cover someone else's work, so you're loaded with so much work, you'll probably feel more stressed, more tired, and disconnect from your community and your normal work after work life. So yes, that affects you in a long term, maybe not suddenly, but in a long term that will show a lot of disconnection there, and that's why we call it psychological. But not just that, going back to the screen, there is classical chemical hazards. We all see cupboards at our work where it's pointing out dangerous, please do not touch it, get the special gear, especially the gloves. If ergonomics were covered, if we were working in the hospital industry, which no one does, we will see these signs, especially in the department where we have chemotherapy, radiation for our patients, and doctors, specifically doctors and nurses, would need to have their special gear and protective clothing. So that's another hazard. Biological, we haven't mentioned it at all. Why do we have biological hazards? So we said, yes, we do have physical, yes, we have chemical, biological. How they connect? They're very closely connected, because if we have any potential sickness, illness happening in the area, in our environment where we're working, would we be happy to go and work where we know, oh, everyone's been sick? We would say, oh, everyone's coughing, or people having diarrhea, and so on and so on. Or we heard about the mosquito from South America going in Europe. People were showing a lot of concerns about that as well. How would that affect us if we were to go in a workplace environment where people are sick, unwell, and a lot of bacteria? And where does it come from? It comes from not storing the food properly. So if you go and have a kitchen in your work office and you see the fridge is broken, you would probably be concerned, because you don't want your lunch from home to be sitting in a fridge not working properly and get sick. If you're using the microwave, for example, and you're not using it properly, your food will be potentially get some bacteria, and once you're eating it, not physically outside, but in your body, it will be affecting you. And this is how people normally, not being closely connected and informed, they will normally get these injuries or sicknesses, because they're so not disconnected. We've all seen signs. In previous jobs, these jobs and other jobs, you probably recognize some of this. but if you like any of the copies, I shall provide you with that. We potentially did cover the causes of injuries with all of our slides and open questions, so thank you for that. Risk management approaches. We have 5 steps. You do all have a copy. If remember, yes, you all have the copies of that. So we can. If you do have any questions, please ask, and I can explain. Reporting a hazard is one of the very, very important topic to discuss, because reporting a hazard can have different level. High risk, medium, and low risk. Do we need to report it if it's a low risk? Does it have to be medium or high? It's a question that we need to ask ourselves. But then again, we're all working in different industries. We all need to closely look at your work health and safety policies at your work. Now, what is a risk assessment? How do we assess it? We do need to be very close to the area. Or do we need to be far away and wait for someone to tell us all about it? Well, risk assessment is normally done on answering some of this question. How likely is that hazard event will occur? And how severe the injury will be? So it's again coming to our common sense. Discovering, for example, we have someone working in a floral shop. If you have parents coming with their children, would you leave your scissors on the table, walk away, go in a back room to get more flowers, leave the scissors where there is a toddler running around with their parents, they're so curious, beautiful flowers in a shop, scissors on the table. That's a potential hazard. So yes, we do need to assess our environment and potentially discover and say yes, that's a hazard, that should not happen. Should the water bucket and the mop be there when I go in the office, or someone's working in a police government job, policeman takes the guns out, would you be concerned? You would be assessing that as, yes, there is a risk, am I in a danger? Management strategy is something that helps us to reduce the injuries and hazards and any potential illness. The control measures is the elimination, substitution, isolation, injury control, administrative control, personal protective equipment, as we discussed it earlier on. So again, thank you for giving all these beautiful examples, and have a look at some of the gear provided, I would say. Now it's time to conclude our study session, and I will be providing you with quick multiple question choice paper. Just check the paper, the pen that I've been putting on the table, that they're working. And let me know when you're ready. I'll just put a little, some more printouts on the table, so you can read all this information back.
So if you want to get more information, we're just going to the link and
we'll discuss about that when we're finished. Questions, potential hazards, slippery fall, cables, tripping, water slip, sharp tools, trip hazard, excellent, very good. Then I can see all these two client trainers. Yes, to go back to your question, the primary readings are on the back of the pre-part. So this is all e-training and map signers from the government department that you can find the link on internet. Potentially, I have given you pre-parts or other readings that might help you with your background industry to read more about work health and safety. So just to summarize again very quickly because we ran out of time, we've been talking about the workers, work office, place, where we work, what is hazard, what is injury. Following the work safety policies is very important and crucial. Every industry has their own work health and safety policies, so please read those back. And if you do have any questions, please don't be afraid to ask your supervisors or managers in regards to it. Thank you for today.